Welcome to another video on the ExaDocs channel. Now we've got a hot topic lined up for today. I'm going to actually dive into what it takes to port a network operating system onto Whitebox hardware. And not just that, we've got iOS XR running on OCP compliant hardware for the service provider access market. More on that in just a bit. Okay, before we begin, some disclaimers. First of all, what this video is not. This is not an introduction to network disaggregation. So if you're looking to learn more about network disaggregation in general, I'd love to be able to expand more on it, but that's probably another video for another day. I'm also going to assume that you have an intermediate level of understanding around the concepts of network disaggregation and of the OCP, that is the Open Compute Project community at large and its goals. In case you do not, I have some links down in the description below, so click on those to know more. First, the burning question, how do you enable iOS XR on OCP compliant hardware? But before we begin, how do you actually enable any NOS for that matter on Whitebox hardware? You need four primary decision steps. Step number one, select the hardware. Now, this kind of seems obvious, but it is probably the most crucial step. In the end, you want to be able to select probably an OCP compliant hardware because you automatically get to utilize all of the different ONL modules that have already been published on GitHub. Where exactly? Well, head over to the Open Compute Project GitHub organization and look at the ONL Git repo. And you'll find modules for just about all of the OCP compliant hardware that are available in the market today. Now, in addition to that, you are of course interested in things like port density and the AC capabilities. Now, the port density would be determined by your own network's requirement. How do you want to scale out? How many devices go into your leaf? How many devices go into the spine, etc. In addition to that, the AC capabilities, of course, determine what your software stack, the NOS, will eventually be able to support. So choose your AC capabilities and hence choose the hardware appropriately. Okay, step number two, integrate with the platform. Now, here by the platform, I basically mean components like fans, optics, power modules, and other sensors. Now, of course, for these components, all of the modules that you need to expose their functionality to higher layers can basically be integrated into your kernel based on the ONL modules that are already published on GitHub. So fetch these modules, port them into the kernel that you will be utilizing for the NOS at hand. Now, in addition to that, take a look at this particular graphic here. So there are two particular layers of interest here, the platform abstraction layer and the optics abstraction layer. Now, the platform abstraction layer is basically the layer within the NOS that is going to integrate with any layer underneath it that exposes the APIs based on the functionalities provided by the kernel modules that have been loaded. So the technique that is actually used to expose these APIs to the platform abstraction layer is dependent on the hardware that was selected in step number one. So if you selected a hardware with a BMC, then expect that something like OpenBMC might be utilized by the platform abstraction layer to actually integrate these platform functionalities. On the other hand, if you selected a hardware without a BMC, the typical technique is to use something like ONLP, that is the ONL platform library, to actually expose the APIs required for the platform abstraction layer. All right, further quick piece of information around the optics abstraction layer. Most of the effort in the ONL community in recent months has moved to create a standard layer across a wide variety of platforms in order to handle optics. Now, this layer is generally referred to as the Open Optical Monitoring or the OOM layer. You will find that most of the modules that dealt with SFPs, etc. for these platforms have been moved out in favor of OOM. So in the future, expect that optics abstraction layers will generally leverage something like the OOM layer to be able to handle whatever optics are being plugged into the system. Okay, step number three, integrate with the ASIC SDK. You really just depend on the ASIC vendor to provide the right modules or the APIs so that the hardware abstraction layer or the HAL within your NOS can easily integrate with whatever APIs are being provided to it. So these could be, of course, kernel level APIs based on sort of ASIC SDK modules provided by the ASIC vendor. Or these could be open APIs like OpenNSL. Finally, step number four, you need to build an installer image based on the device provisioning paradigm that is used by the hardware that you selected. Now, typically for OCP compliant hardware, this technique tends to be ONI. This would therefore imply that if you're able to build an ONI compatible installer image for your NOS, then the device on boot up will simply use the discovery mechanisms within ONI to fetch that installer image, install it, and then finally boot the NOS for you. Now that we've considered all of the different design steps that you would take to enable a generic NOS on a generic white box hardware, we can pretty much extrapolate what it actually takes for iOS XR to be enabled on OCP compliant hardware. Follow all of the four steps that I just mentioned, select an OCP compliant hardware, and make sure that iOS XR in this case has all of the abstraction layers available to easily integrate based on the platform that is selected. Let's take a look at a demo that I have in hand. I'm actually going to work with an OCP compliant hardware. This is the EdgeCore AS781664X. So it is a 64 port hardware, again 100 gig L2L3 forwarding capabilities, and we're going to utilize this to see how we can install iOS XR, an ONI compatible installer image of iOS XR, on this piece of hardware, and then check out how it performs with respect to platform integration as well as the features that are made available. The topology that we intend to use is shown here. Consider this to be part of a larger access network, in this case consisting of a single spine and three leaves as shown. Now two of the leaves, that is leaf 1 and leaf 2, along with the spine, are all NCS5501 devices from Cisco. Whereas the leaf 3 here is the AS7816, which is the white box hardware on top of which we intend to install and boot iOS XR. Now we need to create an installer image that is compatible with the device provisioning mechanism that is used on the hardware. AS7816 uses ONI as the device provisioning mechanism, so we create an ONI compatible installer image for iOS XR. Now ONI has a variety of different discovery techniques that it can utilize to figure out the location of the installer image. In this case, we utilize its capability to use DHCP transactions and then obtain something like a default URL option to figure out what the location of the installer image is, download it, and then install and boot iOS XR. Therefore, to start off, let's take a look at the DHCP server and the configuration we have in place there. As you can see, that for the AS7816 host, we can match on a variety of different parameters. In this case, we choose to do it based on the MAC address. The most important setting, of course, is the default URL setting that you see here. Now, this setting indicates the location on the web server of the installer image that ONI will try to pick up and then try to download and install iOS XR. Let's head over to the device. On the device, the grub menu is currently up and we've highlighted the uninstall OS option. Now, this option will erase the existing partitions on the device and will reboot the device to attempt installation of a new OS using ONI. So, let's start. As you can see, the device has now gone into the OS uninstall mode and is erasing the internal mass storage devices. Now, this process in itself will take quite a while, so we'll actually speed up this part of the video until we get to the point where the device reboots in order to attempt ONI. Now this is where the DHCP server will come into play. As the device goes through ONI, it will send out a DHCP request requesting the default URL option, and as part of the reply, the DHCP server will provide the location of the installer image. It just started the discovery process, and there, it's now attempting to download the installer image based on the reply from the DHCP server. Now, as the installation process continues, let's take a look at what's going to happen once the device boots up. Now, once the device boots up, zero-touch provisioning will be the first process that kicks off. Zero-touch provisioning, or ZTP, is part of the operational feature set within iOS XR. Now, the workflow for ZTP actually resembles the workflow for ONI, as shown here. As soon as ZTP kicks off, the device will send out DHCP requests requesting the location of a config or a script file, and this script could either be in Python or Bash. Let's go back to the device. In a short while, we should see that as soon as the management interface is detected, the first set of DHCP requests will go out as part of the ZTP process. To be prepared for that, on our syslog server, we have a tail-f running to receive the syslog messages that are sent out by the device as the ZTP process executes the Python script that it downloads. Great, so the management interface just came up. The ZTP process should kick off in just a few seconds. And at this point, you can see that the ZDP script is trying to replace the system config with the downloaded config as part of the script logic. And there, this is the config that was essentially applied by the ZDP script, and the ZDP process is now termed complete. Now let's head over to the device. The ZDP script sets up the user Cisco on the device. Let's take a look at the show version. And we have iOS XR 651 running on Acton AS7816. Now let's take a look at the platform integration. For this purpose, we'll actually compare some of the outputs in the iOS XR CLI with the corresponding outputs of ONLP dump running in XR Bash. Let's first take a look at the status of the fans on the system. Now this represents the current fan speed and RPM of each of the fans on the system, including the power module fans. And if you get the corresponding output in ONLP dump, we see pretty much the same values show up for the chassis fans as indicated by the iOS XR CLI. Similarly, let's take a look at the values associated with the temperature sensors on the device. In iOS XR, we get this, and in ONLP dump, we can again see, for example, the CPU core pretty much has the same value in degrees Celsius in either output. And probably the last part, let's take a look at how the optics are integrated with the system. The show inventory details on iOS XR should basically show up the four optics modules that have been identified. And similarly, in ONLP dump, we see all of the four optics modules here as well. Excellent. So the platform integration is pretty seamless. Now let's take a look at some of the features that are enabled as part of iOS XR coming up. The ZDP script, of course, enabled a particular running config on the system. So let's take a look at that. Great, so we've got quite a few things, ISIS, BGP, bridge domains, a bundle interface, etc. So if you take a look at the ISIS config, based on this config, the router should be able to learn routes from the spine as well as the other leaves in the topology. There you go. And similarly, you've got the BGP config here, along with the VPN v4 address family. And we can also see routes in BGP. Lastly, since we have a bundle interface connecting this device to the spine, let's take a look at how the bundle is currently performing. Great, so LACP is operational and the 200 gig interfaces are active and part of the bundle. Great, so all of the iOS XR features that were configured pretty much work as advertised. And that's pretty much the end of the demo. In addition, what I'd like to be able to touch upon are the different deployment paradigms that we can look at when we consider iOS XR on Whitebox hardware. I would essentially classify them into two types. There is native deployment, that is iOS XR acting as a complete software stack. So all of the different abstractions, the ONLP libraries, the platform modules, etc., that we need to integrate together are basically supplied to the end user in the form of a single installer package. In this case, as we saw, the ONI compatible installer image basically contains everything indicated by the red box here. Another type of deployment could be a container-based deployment as shown here. In this case, iOS XR acts as an application. The integrator would typically bring their own rootfs or kernel, and iOS XR would be delivered as a container on top of the system, allowing the abstraction layers to be integrated into the container image itself, whereas the rest of the system is managed by the integrator. And that's that for the demo. All right, so let's bring everything back in together. We just saw how we were able to basically use an ONI compatible installer image of iOS XR and just seamlessly boot it on top of an OCP compliant hardware. In addition to that, we enabled features generally relevant to the service provider access market, and they pretty much worked without a glitch. And when it came to platform integration with the OCP compliant hardware, we just saw that the abstraction layers within iOS XR made the entire experience pretty much seamless. This is exactly how iOS XR behaves when it runs on Cisco hardware, for example. Okay, so if there's one takeaway from this entire exercise, it should be that iOS XR's architecture with the suitable abstractions at the platform integration layer is what actually allows us to be so portable across Cisco and Whitebox hardware. Oh, and before I sign off, we're a bunch of network engineers and developers that are looking to create useful content for the networking community at large. So if you'd like to check out some of the content that we've actually put out, head over to xrdocs.github.io. You'll actually find a link for that in the description below, and I'm sure you'll find it worth your time.